Hotel family, welcome back to the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. Well, she's back with us, one of our favorite success scientists, Dr. Nzingha Dalila. Today we're going to be talking about something she created, the Social Justice Involvement Scale. And as many of you may know, may not know, but need to know, she is a doctor of consulting, a counseling, education, and comedic metaphysical healer, and a clinical researcher. She holds a license in clinical counseling and supervision, and a license in chemical dependency counseling as well. And she's the owner of Noetica Wellness Center for Mental Health Research, Development, and Treatment. I forgot what part of Ohio. We'll get into that in a moment. But with all that being said, welcome back, Dr. Nzingha Dalila.
Hotep.
Well, what part, where's your facility?
In Cincinnati, Ohio.
Cincinnati, Ohio. Okay. Wow, every time I hear Cincinnati, I think of just to show my age. You remember that? You probably don't, because you're so young.
I think we're the same age.
Oh, okay. WKRP in Cincinnati. Remember that show?
Yeah. Okay. Everybody always says that's the only thing. It's like the only thing that we're known for.
I guess I don't know. That could be good. That could be bad.
Yeah.
You know, it's a matter of how you look at it. Now, you and I have had countless conversations and have done a lot of work together, and more you than me, and in the field of race-based traumatic stress, injury, and violence. And all this time, you had what you call a social justice involvement scale that you developed. And I said, well, this is amazing. This needs to go out here. The family needs to have access to it. And everybody needs to have access to it. So let's talk about it, and let's dig in deep as to what it is, why you developed it, and how it's going to benefit the community. So that being said, what is the social justice involvement scale, and why did you create it?
Okay. Well, it's a psychometric instrument, and for people who aren't familiar with that term in behavioral health, it's a way of measuring a psychological construct or a behavior, mental health behavior. People might be familiar with, taking a depression test or something for anxiety or something like that. Well, somebody had to create something to measure that. And so what this basically is, it's a measurement of the degree that somebody is involved in social justice change. The reason why I created it is because I was looking at mental health from an African perspective is what I'm always looking at. And recognizing, because we've talked about race-based traumatic stress injury and people talk about generational trauma and these kind of things that impact us. And as a clinician, I'm always interested in a researcher, I'm interested in how we can more effectively treat these conditions that we're victims to. And most of the time when we've talked about epigenetics and things like that, so we understand that the environment that we're in creates certain perceptions and behaviors that then begin to change our very DNA, those kind of things. We feel anxious and depressed and all these things because of the things that are going on outside of us. And so in terms of treatment, I was asking, the question, what is it that we need to do to help liberate through treatment? What can clinicians do through treatment to be a part of liberating our people from white supremacy, from all of the oppression and the conditions that create the trauma? What we usually do when you go to see a counselor or a psychologist is they need to figure out exactly what is the problem that we need to address in treatment. So say, for instance, somebody comes in and says, you know, I'm having a, you know, I keep having a difficult time at work, or I'm having a difficult time in my relationship, or my job sent me because they said, you know, I'm just, you know, too angry or whatever, you know, so that's the reason why you came. But I have, as a clinician, I have to figure out why you're doing that. Mm-hmm. And so we do an assessment. So we might have you do some psychometric instruments, give you some psychometric instruments, some tests, ask you a series of questions about your life, all those kind of things, so that we get a really full picture of what's really going on. Oh, you're having problems at home because of stuff that happened in your childhood. Uh-huh. Or you're having problems at work because, you know, of racial violence or whatever. But sometimes the reason why people say they're coming, often it's our job to figure out, to lift the hood on the car, to really look inside and see what the issue is.
Yeah, they might be labeling the effect, but there's a deeper cause.
Right, right. Like I use car analogies a lot, even though I don't know anything about them except where to put the gas. But I know that if it's not running, I have to take it somewhere. And I say, it's making this noise. It's doing this thing. Uh-huh. I don't know what, but it's not working out. You know, and so in our lives, when things aren't working out, and you've tried everything else, then you go to see a counselor or a psychologist, and then we do these assessments, and we try to figure out what the real issue is. We can't give you treatment until we figure out what the real problem is. Uh-huh, it's like, uh-huh, if you took your car to a mechanic, you know, they changed the tires. It's like, it wasn't even the tires wasn't the problem. You know, it was something else. Uh-huh. You just don't throw something at it and hope that works, like cooking spaghetti and throw it against the wall. Just hope for the best. You know, we got to do an assessment. And so going back to what we're experiencing, the generational trauma, the race-based traumatic stress, these things that happen in our community that keep us mentally enslaved, we need to really be able, when people come for counseling, we need to have an assessment that's looking at those things. Because a lot of times, because we're not taught that in school. We're not taught, clinical counselors, psychologists, social workers, we're not taught in school how to look for this. And I've been doing this for, you know, almost 30 years. And there, and no matter where I go, when you're given like tools to assess your clients, there's nothing that really acknowledges that. Uh-huh, uh-huh. It's always looking for something like, you know, depression or anxiety or PTSD or, you know, OCD or those kind of things. But it doesn't look at the system of white supremacy and how that affects the things that you're presenting.
I kind of see this, yeah, this scale fitting very well with, in a sense, the diagnosis of racial battle fatigue. In terms of scale and level, what impact does RBF have on you? I'm always having this chicken or the egg conversation with Dr. William A. Smith about which comes first, racial battle fatigue or race-based traumatic stress injury and violence. My hypothesis is that race-based traumatic stress injury and violence comes first, which creates more racial battle fatigue over time.
Yes.
So this scale then kind of gives us a understanding between, you know, where we're at from a 1 to a 10, in a sense, of the impact that these hostile racial forces are having on our bodies and our minds.
Not exactly.
Okay.
It's okay. It's. I know it's kind of like I'm getting a long way to it, but it's getting to, I'm talking about treatment. So I know I was talking about assessment, but then in order to treat the problem, you have to be able to assess certain behaviors. So like in racial battle fatigue, we can identify certain, like what does it look like? Mm-hmm. Certain behaviors, what are you doing that you can say that's what that is? I can tell you about certain symptoms in race-based traumatic stress injury that look like that. But in treatment, there's something that it looks like, something that you're doing. I kick the dog every day when I come home, or I'm always yelling, or I'm drinking, or something like those are things that you're doing. But in order to change it, if it's got to do with the system that we live in, then from an African liberation perspective, we also need to be about changing the system. But what happens with racial battle fatigue, WUSI anxiety, those kind of things that I talked about before, people just give up. So what I'm trying to do, or what I do with the social justice involvement scale, is I help people look at how this is affecting your inability to engage in changing the society. What happens is we become apathetic, we get frozen, we get so exhausted that we don't engage anymore in the change that we need to change in the society. And I'm trying to help people to understand, to see that the things that they're experiencing is getting in the way of their motivation. They don't have a desire anymore because they're so exhausted, or they're so worried, or they've internalized these racist ideas about ourselves that we don't feel like we can make a change. And if you don't feel that you can change anything, then you're not going to stay in treatment.
Fascinating. Fascinating. You know, earlier today, I was telling you I had an interview. I had an interview with Karen Parsons, plays Hillary on Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. And she has her first novel out. And it's about a young girl who's ethnically mixed. You know, I think, you know, one parent is white, the other parent is black, and she's light-skinned. And this is in the Jim Crow era. And it's a fascinating story that she weaves. And then there's a story of an actual, the first and the youngest black boy, 14 years old, who went to the electric chair for being accused of killing two white women. And it was a lie. Yeah. And what was fascinating about this conversation with Karen is that her mother, who's black, was raised in Jim Crow. Came up in Jim Crow and the atrocities that she faced. But she ended up marrying a white guy and producing Karen Parsons. And Karen Parsons now is married to a white guy. She's got a beautiful son and daughter who are mixed. And what I'm finding was fascinating about the conversation that I was having with her is that racism is a mental illness unto itself. That the fact, in my opinion, me doing the work that I'm doing, you doing the work that we're, everybody who is doing some kind of work in this space, the work that they're doing is their mental health, if you will, dealing with the race-based traumatic stress injury and violence. They don't have a framework like you have, and the scale would be able to possibly give them, but we're doing this work so that we can exercise and extract this invisible thing that we feel every day, but also grew up and shaped us and molded us, and then the things we see vicariously in terms of trauma outwardly that we're constantly seeing. So I thought it was very fascinating, and the scale is fascinating to me, but it's really fascinating to me in terms of assessing the mental health of someone in terms of are we at our optimal selves to do social justice?
Yeah. There's I had to take this idea, social justice. What does that mean? It means a lot of different things to different people, I imagine. I mean, we talk about it a lot, but, you know, in order to say, why aren't our people fighting and freeing ourselves against this injustice, we have to be able to say, well, what does it look like? Can I measure it? And so, you know, my research looked at you can use different theories. I decided what resonated for me was a theory that looked at a social justice meaning distributing the resources, the wealth, liberty, privileges, equally in a society such that the least are given priority. So that's justice. That's the framework that I work at when I'm looking at, you know, what, because we don't really talk about what would, you know, we say we're oppressed and we want to be free. What does freedom look like? How do you know when you get there? You know?
Well, good point.
Yeah. Right. You know, so I'm looking at that framework of that theory of social justice. It's actually based on a man named John Rawls, Rawls. And I'm just looking at that theory. Doesn't mean that other ones aren't as valid, but it's just more, it's concise. And also what I look at is, are people engaged in any kind, and the idea, and that idea of social justice, do people think that's realistic? Uh-huh. You know, people can't fight for freedom if they don't even believe that that's a possibility, uh-huh. that they have the right to have it.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. This is the way it's always been. It ain't gonna get no better, no matter what I do. It ain't gonna get
right.
So I'm not going to vote. I'm not going to participate. I'm not going to, however that shows up.
Yeah. So, you know, I believe that, you know, a system.
Let me ask you this. Is non-participation an equal form of mental health issue than those who act up and act out?
When you say act up, act out, are you talking about like rioting, or what do you?
No, those who are, you know, the angry black woman, the angry black man, but then there are those who are just passive and say, you know what, I'm out, no mas, I'm not going to participate.
That's a really, really good point. It's a really good point. It's almost like two sides of the same coin. Mm-hmm. It's both of them are a reaction to the conditions, but neither one of them gets us any further towards any kind of sense of justice or freedom. And so that's a really good point. And when I think I mentioned the racial identity development, and that there's a certain stage when people get into the, you know, the anger, the acting out, all of that. And that's more of the immersion stage, you know, where you're, you know, everything black is right, everything white is wrong. And, you know, I'm just gonna, you know, wrap myself in this and just be totally militant. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. I'm just saying, for some people, getting to a point of really being able to organize, it can be very ineffective because you can burn out, right? Like a shooting star. I mean, you can only hope maintain that for so long and be effective. Of course, you know, a lot of people organize and then actually have some real revolutions. So I don't try and dismiss that. But what can happen again, as I mentioned before, is that people in that stage can experience that wuxi anxiety, where they're worried that they're not militant enough, that they're not Black enough, that they're, you know, straddling the fence between, you know, trying to be, you know, super, you know, Black, all Black, militant, rage all the time, and then feeling like, well, there's some things that I grew up with that I'm still attached to, and that causes frustration and anxiety inside themselves. And then they can kind of start to regress and go back, and that's when you get to that learned helplessness, and you're just like, I give up, you know, it's just not worth it. I can't, I, here I am, 50 years old, I still haven't, I'm still in the same place I was when I was in college or something like that. Nothing's really changed for me. And that's why, so it's important in therapy to have these kind of conversations. Counselors don't even have a language. They don't have they don't have a tool. They don't have any way to engage brothers and sisters in this kind of conversation. It's frightening if you're not used to it.
I can imagine. And I would also assume that it's more damaging when we go to counsel, seek counseling, whether it's something we seek or maybe it's forced upon us, depending upon the situation where we have to go. But we're sitting there with the people who have done us the most harm.
Yeah. Yeah. Or, you know, and even, you know, I would say well-meaning, you know, brothers and sisters, we're just not taught. Yeah. And I tell you,
but they're not qualified. Yeah, it's not possible. Right. It's just, right. You know, it has nothing to do with, this is not academia or how they are as a technician.
Right. Yeah. It's asking somebody to work on a Jaguar and you've only worked on, you know, Yugos or whatever, you know, I mean, it's like, I don't know what to do with this.
I had an argument. Well, not an argument. It was more of a slam dunk from my perspective, but I just had a conversation with someone. I said, you know, okay, let me ask you this. This was a person who was Jewish. I said, if you were raped by a German, would you want a German counselor or technician to sit down and talk to you about what just happened to you?
Right.
Pow. Right. The story. Okay, I see what you're saying, Philippe.
Or somebody who had been taught by Germans.
Right. Right.
I mean, that's all they have. That's all they have in their toolbox, too.
Right. Right.
In the toolbox, they're like, well, it's either this or this. That's all I got. We can work, you know, no matter what you bring to me, these are the things that I can work on because that's all I've been taught.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So my work is about trying to provide something different for brothers and sisters who are clinicians. And it's a self-administered test.
So I was going to ask you, is this something that you do and oversee, or is this something that they take? And how is the test taken or administered?
Well, again, it's self-administered. So the thing is you can, it's got 21 questions. It's very short, takes like 15 minutes. You just answer some questions like, strongly disagree to strongly agree with these statements. And then you get a score. And the score can, depending on what the score is, gives me or can give you a certain indication of where you're at in terms of your ability to fight.
Wow.
To work towards your own freedom.
Wow.
That's really what it is.
Damn.
That's what it is.
Damn, Doc, that's badass. Who are you right now?
You're so
great. What? Oh my God. It's like, okay, do I get the dashiki or do I not get the dashiki? That's what is my score? Am I going to get my pick, my Afro pick, or not get my Afro? Or how many Afro picks do I get? You know, if it's one, or do I get 20? If I get 20, I'm a badass out here. I'm ready to fight.
Well, so, you know, and there's, you know, it's not a pass or fail, you know, but there's low scores, medium scores, and high scores. Mm. And depending on what your score is, that means some certain things. And I provide some suggestions for what you can do. So if you're
after taking the test, can I come to you and sit down and say, and you score it, and you, let's say that, you know, I completely have no capacity to fight for my own freedom. Mm-hmm. Will you help me dissect and delineate why?
Right. Yes. Yes. And you can see as soon as you take it, they'll, based on your scores at the end of the test, it'll say what this means and what are some suggestions.
Wow.
Right? As soon as you take it.
Everybody needs to take this test. Everybody, yeah. Everybody. Now, one of the things that I think might be a bit confusing that I want you to clear up for the family, that this is not a test for people who just want to go out and be join Black Lives Matter per se. And you have, you know, social justice is not just marching. Then when you talk about for their own freedom, can you go a little deeper in explaining that it you know, it could be as and I'm assuming this, but you can correct me if I'm wrong. It could be as much as just loving yourself more, taking better care of yourself more, which gives you more ability to fight these forces. But this is not something where it's testing you to physically go out and become an organizer and join Black Lives Matter and to go down to the police station and slap white people when they come by and all that. It's not that situation.
It's whatever you feel like you're ready to do. I'm saying that if you, because social justice work can be working in your community. Mm-hmm. It can be organizing, you know, after school, you know, African rites of passage programs for after school for children. That can be social justice. You know, it can be starting a book club. It can be, you know, showing up at your neighborhood community meetings. It could be running for some community seat in the office in your town. It could be whatever you feel like you want to do to make a change, because this is how white supremacy is impacting your life right now. You're feeling like, I look all around me and I see that it's a food desert in my neighborhood. There's no food. You know, and I'm, you know, some people are more connected to the medical issues that we experience because of white supremacy. Some people are more into, you know, police, you know, brutality and want to fight that fight, you know, and whatever way that you feel like you want to do that fight, you can do that. And based on the score, if you feel like, you know, it's really low and there's maybe some things you got to work on before you get to that point. Maybe you got to work on just really kind of loving yourself, you know, before you can get out there and do anything else, you know,
thank you for that. That's good. I needed to know, like, you know, what are the levels and really what is, so what does social justice look like internally and externally? Because I think a lot of people might be hearing this for the first time, might not have a clear understanding of that. How did you come about this scale and this work?
Well, you know, like I said before, I've been, everything I do, I always am looking at it in terms of liberation, mm-hmm. you know, and as a clinician, as a social scientist, you know, I'm there, you know, I have to use my skills for liberation in this way, you know, and so I was looking at why do so many people, there's so many of us that are experiencing mental illnesses because of the society that we live in, and the illness itself keeps us down. So white supremacy, it's the way that it's designed, its function is to continue to maintain supremacy by keeping other people mentally enslaved and believing that we're inferior. And that belief keeps us already enslaved. They don't have to put up, people don't have to build, you know, fences and put chains around our neck and all that stuff. Mentally, we've done that ourselves and we do that to each other. So for us as a mental practitioner, behavioral health therapist, my job should be to try to help people break those chains.
Well, yeah, and you do it, and you do it well. That was, what was that? I'm aging myself again. Is that LL Cool J doing it well? When I think of social justice, so for instance, so I would assume my social justice work is this show.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now let me ask you this. So if I took, I'm already doing it, but if I took this test to see where I'm at, would it allow me to do it better? Or would it just allow me mentally to deal with the stress of doing this better?
That's a good question. It has some, to come up, I'm going to answer your question. It has some subscales. And okay. Subscales can give you some indications of certain things that can be helpful. I was trying to think of an analogy, but I can't quite, yeah. But let's say this, the idea of social justice change. So it's not just social justice, because I talked about what social justice means, but for somebody to make a change, they also have to have, from my perspective, in terms of African liberation, they have to have three things, maybe five, three things, basically. It tests for this idea of social justice, how much you believe in that exists and that you have a right to it. How empowered you feel. Do you feel like, you know, if you have a right to something that you can go get it? And also your racial identity, how much you feel it, love yourself, how much of a me that you have a right to live, exist in this world and take up space here, you know? And so sometimes you get a total scale of that high, medium, low. But even within those high, medium, lows, it tells you the scores on those three different things about where you score in terms of your racial identity, in terms of your sense of empowerment, in terms of social justice, your ideas, your belief in social justice. And a combination of some other things. So looking at those subscales can give you some ideas about where you are in that whole scale. And so there might be some things you might score high, but you might have scored a little lower in some of those subscales than you might have thought. That could give you some indications of some things that you might want to work on. And also, if somebody scores high, there's also things that we're not immune, as you know, which is why you do this show and you talk about it all the time. People who are, you know, woke, you know, it's exhausting. It's exhausting work. You and I have talked about just how exhausting this can be. And it's also really important that you do some things to take care of yourself so that you can, you know, be here at the end, you know, instead of, you know,
and not only be here but be of value and yeah. with right frame of mind and cognizant, you know, that's going to be a trip. Let me ask you this: is there a particularly right or wrong time to take this test? Is it a test that should be taken when you are in a particular mindset, or will those nuances of life versus taking it in the day versus taking it in the evening when you're tired have any effect on the outcome?
That's a really good point. You know, I think that it's more in line with your belief systems. And so if you have had some really horrible experience that you just came through, it might affect how you're feeling today. I mean, I know sometimes we feel a certain way because things have happened, but then once we kind of calm down, we're able to look at it and think, okay, it's not completely the way that I was thinking when I was standing in that situation. Uh-huh. Now that I get to come back and look at it a little bit. But it is, but it you know, so I mean, those things could be some variability to that. But I will say that this instrument, it's not just something that I just, you know, sat and made up. It's something that actually, you know, I was watching Dave Chappelle, and I thought, you know what, I'm gonna make something, you know. It has some statistical analysis that was done in relationship to being items being generated by groups of people, reviewed by experts, and then tested, some statistical analysis done to see the reliability and the validity of the constructs, and the constructs of these ideas of social justice, empowerment, racial identity. And so that, you know, the analysis of it verifies that you can do it over and over and over again, and you'll probably get the same result. Mm-hmm. Now, with that being said, you could do some things differently after you've taken it, and then maybe 3 months, 6 months later, take it again and see if it's made an impact. And that's the whole point. Again, it's to direct treatment, it's to direct change. And you don't necessarily have to be in counseling to get that treatment. There's suggestions. I said, when you take the test and you can see based on the scores, I have some suggestions of some things you can do. Some of that might be helpful to go to counseling to get some work on, but you could just take it and run with it if you want to. But the idea is if you're based on your scores, that hopefully you would feel motivated to like, okay, I see these are some suggestions. Maybe I'll look into that. And then maybe come back six months later, do it again. See if that has changed.
Wow, that's powerful. So family, there's a link below where you will be able to sign up and take the test and see where you're at in terms of your social justice efficacy, if you will. after which they can contact you if they have further questions or need help with. Will this test trigger someone to say, oh, you know what, maybe I do need some counseling work, maybe I do need to speak with someone, because based upon the answers assessment, they might find out something about themselves that they didn't know. They might have a false sense of self, if you will, prior to taking this test.
Right. You know, and the purpose of the instrument is to really help counselors to have a tool to engage in a real conversation that's going to help liberate our people, instead of just talking with a client about how they're unhappy in their marriage or how they feel depressed. This is something that someone could contact me, or someone could take it to another counselor and go, this is how we're scored on this. I didn't realize this, and I want to talk about this. We've been spending months talking about, you know, me losing weight or feeling better about myself and all this stuff. And this is something that nobody ever talked to me about.
I love that. I love that. This is fantastic. All right. Dr. Nzingha Dalila, family, she's a goddess. And that's what goddess and netchers and the set batis do, is they sit up and do this type of work and to empower our lives. I just can't thank you enough for your contribution and being healthy enough to do your level of social justice work, which is amazing.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
All right, Queen. Hotep.
Hotep.
Hotep family.